Good day and welcome to our Memorial Day service, our Memorial Day weekend service. And I'd like to begin today by stating the following truth, and these truths should be self-evident. God is not a Republican. I'm going to say it again. God is not a Republican, and God is most certainly not affiliated with the political parties of the Democrats, the liberals, or the progressives, or any others out there. And now catch this one. God is not even an American. I know on Memorial Day, that almost sounds sacrilegious, but God is not an American. God is the creator of the heavens and the earth. He is our God. And we today, we're going to celebrate our God and the blessings that he's given to us. Specifically, we're going to celebrate the blessings of this country called the United States of America. For while God is not an American, he has blessed our country greatly. We're also going to celebrate specifically the men and women that he has raised up in order to establish this country and to defend her. So today we're going to praise him in song. We're going to praise him as we remember what he has done in and through the USA. And if we ask God to bless the USA, it is in that vein that he is a giver of all good things, his love, this country, our freedom, are praiseworthy indeed. Follow along as I read Psalm 145. Psalm 145, I will extol you, my God, O King. I will bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you, and I will praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and highly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall praise your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wonderful works, I will meditate. Men shall speak of the power of your awesome acts, and I will tell of your greatness. They shall eagerly utter the memory of your abundant goodness, and I will shout joyfully of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and great in loving kindness. The Lord is good to all, and his mercies are over all his works. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and your godly ones shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and talk of your power, to make known to the sons of men your mighty acts and the glory of the majesty of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord sustains all who fall and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due time. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and kind in all his deeds. The Lord is near to all who call upon him, to all who call upon him in truth. He will fulfill the desire of those who fear him. He will also hear their cry and will save them. The Lord keeps all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and all flesh will bless his holy name forever and ever. Amen. All right, good morning. And this morning we're also going to start by playing a song for you. And this song is done by the VeggieTales, but it's done with respect in honor of today. So sit back and enjoy this song.
Today I became an official citizen of the USA.
Oh, that's wonderful, Jean-Claude. I remember the day I became a citizen.
I love this country!
If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd worked for all my life. And I had to start again with just my children and my wife.
I'd thank my lucky stars to be living here today. 'Cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away.
And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt
Jean-Claude, Oscar the Polish caterer.
From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea,
from Detroit down to Houston, from New York to L.A., where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say,
bald eagle. Can I have a bald eagle?
I'm not sure that's entirely legal.
I love bald eagles.
Yes, we've established that.
Join me as we sing Onward Christian Soldiers, page 617.
Christ the royal banner.
Samuel 22:2-4 says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened, and do not be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." And in Psalm 46:1 says, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in the time of trouble."
In Congress, July 4th, 1776, the Declaration of Independence. The unanimous declaration of 13 United States of America. When in the course of human events it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve into the political bands which have connected them with another and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind require that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these rights are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation in such principles and organizing its powers in such forms as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Prudence, indeed, will dictate that governments long established should not be changed for light or transient causes, and accordingly, all experience hath shown that mankind are disposed to suffer, while evils are sufferable, than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations pursuing invariably the same object evinces a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty, to throw off such government and to provide new guards for their future security.
Let's continue praising our Lord this morning in the circle of each home, page 535. As we get to page 535, it's amazing as we read that our country was conceived in respect and honor to God. Let's read page 535 of us.
Thank you.
1 Corinthians 16:13 says, "Be on the alert. Stand firm in the faith. Act like men. Be strong."
In Congress, March 4th, 1789, Constitution of the United States. "We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessing of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America."
Amen. Let's continue on with our praise song, "America the Beautiful," page 690 in our hymnals. Says, "Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes." And in Psalms 33, 20 through 22, it says, "Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our helper and our shield. For our heart is glad in him because we trust his holy name. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us even as we hope in you." Amen. The Lord is good.
Gettysburg Address, President Lincoln. 84 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation, or any nation so conceived and so dedicated, can long.
Let's continue on with page 648. I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian.
I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian. I'm not ashamed his name to bear. I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian. I'll take him with me anywhere. I'll tell the world how Jesus saved me and how he gave me a life brand new.
Reply to Governor, Pennsylvania Assembly, November 11, 1755. Those who would give up essential liberty to purchase a little temporary safety deserves neither liberty nor safety.
In John 15:12-15, it says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that one lay down his life for a friend. You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you slaves, for the slave does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you." Please pray with me. Lord, we thank you so much for this day and this opportunity we've had to gather here so far and just to lift our voices in prayer to you, to thank you for this great nation that you've given us, Lord, the way you've raised up men and women to begin this nation, to continue this nation, to defend this nation. Lord, we thank you for the blessings that you've poured out through it. And Lord, we realize you could have done it any way, but this is the way that you've done it. And we are thankful for that. And so as we continue this morning to hear your word and to continue to praise you, may you be glorified. May you take our praises as a sweet incense as it flows to you from our hearts and our spirit and in all things, Lord. May you be glorified. It's in your name we pray. Amen. All right. As if you were with us last week, then you'll remember that I started a sermon series for this week and last week of Joseph the Famine Fighter and how to enslave a nation. We looked at Genesis 41 through 47, and as we went through Genesis 41 through 47, we learned a number of things about what the Israelites went through in their enslavement and what Egypt went through during the famine. We read about how the Pharaoh had the dream, how Joseph told the Pharaoh his dream, interpreted it for him, how he told him what that meant, how Pharaoh set Joseph up and made him second in all of Egypt, and how Joseph stored up food for 7 years during the 7 years of plenty, and how, as Joseph went through that, how he then saved his family, his brothers, his father, and their families, and how he ended up saving Egypt too. God worked in Joseph and through Joseph and prepared Joseph for the task. And so we learned a number of lessons through Joseph. And on the screen, the graphic shows us that we learned that we could trust God no matter what the situation. And that has a lot of relevance today. We can trust God even during this pandemic. God is in control. We learn that Joseph worked as if working for the Lord, that any time in his life there were circumstances that were not good. He was in Potiphar's house as a slave, and yet he worked hard, and Potiphar gave him control of his entire household. He was in prison in Pharaoh's dungeon, and he worked hard, and the jailer put him in charge of the jail. Basically, he was a manager of the jail. We are to work as if we're working for the Lord in all things. We also saw how Joseph forgave his brothers. Joseph saw the big picture, that God was in control, that his brothers, while they intended evil, God made it work for good. God had a plan through all of it, through throwing in the well, through slaved in Potiphar's household, through the time in Pharaoh's dungeon. God was working, and Joseph forgave his brothers because he himself had been forgiven. We are called to forgive as we're forgiven. And then lastly, we saw how we're to be kind and compassionate to others. And so Joseph showed that kindness and compassion even as he enslaved the nation, because they looked to him as a savior. And they thanked him for what he was doing, for taking their very lives in exchange for food. They saw his kindness and his compassion. He worked for the Pharaoh as if he were working for the Lord, and he did what was required of him. But he was kind and compassionate. And these are things that we can apply in our lives. But I said that this week we were going to go on, and we were going to move on to just a few other things that we see from Joseph in that section. Number one, we're going to see that freedom is a privilege and not a right. Freedom is a privilege and not a right. And this is very important to us, because today we live in a nation. You saw what the reading of the Declaration of the Independence. You heard and saw the Constitution. You heard and saw President Lincoln's opening to the Gettysburg Address. And as you see these things and you think about where we are today, we are very much not the land of the free. We heard the VeggieTales song at the beginning, and it talks about our freedom and how we are free, and yet we are very much not free. We're not free to open businesses, in our state at least. We're not free to move as we want to. Throughout, ever since the conception of this country, we've given up more and more freedoms. Freedom is a right, is a privilege, not a right, and it's something that we need to work to maintain and work to hold on to. The Egyptians gave up their freedom. The Egyptians freely gave up their freedom. We also will see that prosperity is not a right, but it's a privilege and it's a responsibility. Joseph helped the Pharaoh prosper, and he gathered together from the abundance that the Lord had given Egypt. He gathered and stored into storage bins, and because he did that, he was responsible, because he was unable to use that food to feed the nation. The other thing we see very briefly is poverty and wealth is not evil. There was poverty, there was wealth. Joseph made the Pharaoh very wealthy, but through that abundance, he had the grain to feed the nation. So poverty and wealth throughout Scripture is not an evil. What we see is how we live in poverty and how we live in prosperity, in our wealth. And in both those situations, we have to realize that God is a God that sustains us, that gives us all things, and that He will provide food in His time to the poor, and He will provide opportunities for us to be His hands and feet, to share the prosperity with others. But the final point I want to make here that we see there is that God's provisions does not require national economic prosperity. We've went through a time in this country where we were growing and growing. Prosperity seemed to be on the horizon for so many in the country. Our nation had the most people at work before this coronavirus hit than it ever has had in the past, as far as the numbers and statistics that they were showing. We were on track as far as those numbers and statistics to be great. Things were going great, national prosperity. And then in an instant, it seems like it was all wiped away. How fast it can turn. The Egyptians went through a time of prosperity, 7 years of plenty. There was so much, they probably felt it would never end. Obviously, they did not store up enough personally to last them through the 7 years of famine, even though it was known that it was coming. Perhaps they felt that it would never end. I know in November and December of last year, people probably did not expect it to end. Investors, the stock market was growing leaps and bounds. There was not an expectation that it would end. And yet, like chaff in the wind, it blew away. And yet, even with the Egyptians, God was able to take care of them. God's provision does not require national economic prosperity. So even today, as our society seems to be on the brink of economic disaster, because governors are shutting down businesses left and right, people who want to work can't work, God is still God, and He can still take care of us. Remember last week I read 1 Peter 2, 13 through 25. I want to read that again briefly. It says, Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether to a king as to the one in authority, or the governors as sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and the praise of those who do right. For such is the will of God, that by doing right you may silence the ignorance of foolish men. Act as free men, and do not use your freedom as a covering for evil, but use it as bondslaves of God. Honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, and honor the king. Servants, be submissive to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and gentle, but also to those who are unreasonable. For this finds favor, if for the sake of conscience towards God, a person bears up under sorrows when suffering unjustly. For what credit is there if when you sin and are harshly treated, you endure it with patience? But if when you do what is right and suffer for it, you patiently endure it, this finds favor with God. For you have been called for this purpose, since Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example for you to follow in His steps. Who committed no sin, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. And while being reviled, he did not revile in return. While suffering, he uttered no threats, but kept entrusting himself to him who judges righteously. And he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. For by his wounds you were healed. For you were continually straying like sheep, but now you have returned to the good shepherd, to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. Amen. As you see the graphic on the screen, essential liberty we have given up freely for security. You see those little news blurbs of Governor Pritzker orders residents to stay home, the lawyers telling businesses that they're opening themselves for lawsuits if they decide to open. Essential liberty and security. Illinois was shut down. But what we want to see from that, Christ was our example. And in that section of Peter, it tells us that we should follow the example of Christ, that our leaders and our rulers are established by God, Romans 13 tells us, and that we are to honor them. In Romans 13, it says, give tax to who tax is due, and honor to who honor is due, respect to who respect is due. And so our governor receives our honor and respect because that's who's been put in as an authority over us. However, Christ's example shows us that even when we're wrongly reviled, even when the authorities are unjust, that we can still show honor and respect. For Philippians, here's four things I want to close with. Four things that we see through Scripture. Philippians, as it relates to our situation now in this pandemic. Philippians 3:17 through 21 says, brethren, join in following my example and observe those who walk according to the pattern you have in us. For many of whom I often told you, and now tell you even weeping, that are enemies of the cross of Christ, those whose end is destruction, whose God is their appetite, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their mind on earthly things. For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly await for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform the body of our humble state into conformity with the body of his glory by the exertion of the power that he has, even to subject all things to himself. Brothers and sisters, we have a citizenship, not of this earth, but of heaven. We are citizens of God Almighty, of his kingdom, of the Lord Jesus Christ, and amen. So as we look out there at what the world does, it matters not that the governor shuts down the state or the president or whatever. We have our citizenship in heaven. So even though we are citizens of the United States and God has given us and placed us in this country, even though we are citizens of Illinois or residents of Illinois, and both of these are great lands and blessed mightily by God, our true citizenship is in heaven, and that helps us endure and stand up. However, we're also told in that 1 Peter section to live as people who are free, not using our freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. We're called to live as free men. Freedom. This is what God created us. We might be under authority, but we are free. We are autonomous. God has created us. We have the ability to think. We are created in his image, and we are to live as free men. And so our citizenship is in heaven, and we live as free men because of that. We are servants of him, not servants of earthly masters. But even if earthly masters are over us, we can live as free men in Christ. Now here's one point I want to make sure we get. Some people will say, well, as Christ is our example, we should live through the oppression. No matter what our governor does, we should just endure it. Because our citizenship is in heaven, we should bear up and under all the pressure. And amen, that is what we're called to do. Let's bear up under all the pressure, under all the injustice. However, one of the problems with that is that there are others who are not in our boat. Some of us have it pretty easy in this pandemic. Our jobs have not ended. We're still getting paid. We're still able to leave the state when we want. We're still able to travel. We have a lot of freedoms, even though we're not so free. And we look at the past and we kind of complain about losing our freedoms, but there's another world in America right now. There's people who have lost their jobs. There's people who have no income coming in. There's people who the governor's actions are directly oppressing. They are poor and they're downtrodden. In Isaiah 1, 16 and 17, God says, "Wash yourselves and make yourselves clean. Remove the evil from your deeds, or the evil of your deeds from my sight. Cease to do evil. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Reprove the ruthless. Defend the orphan. Plead for the widow." This section is in the larger section in Isaiah, and in the very opening of the book of Isaiah. And as we look at that on the screen here, you'll read that Israel had moved far away from the Lord. It says, "Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Give ear to the instruction of our God, you people of Gomorrah. What are your multiplied sacrifices to me, says the Lord? I have had enough of burnt offerings, of rams, and the fat of fed cattle. I take no pleasure in the blood of bulls, lambs, or goats. When you come to appear before me, who requires you of you this trampling of my courts? Bring your worthless offerings no longer. Incense is an abomination to me. New moon and Sabbath, the calling of assemblies, I cannot endure it, and the solemn assembly. I hate your new moon festivals and your appointed feasts. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. So when you spread out your hands in prayer, I will hide my eyes from you. Yes, even though you multiply prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are covered with blood." And then that's verse 16 and 17 says, "Wash yourselves and make yourselves clean. Remove the evil deeds from my sight. Cease to do evil. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Reprove the ruthless. Defend the orphan and plead for the widow." Brothers and sisters, this whole lockdown has been oppressive to many people. And there's people out there struggling and hurting, and it's hidden from so many of us because our life is not like that. We're still working and we're still getting paid. We need to be on guard, and we can still respect our governor. We can still respect our leaders and yet oppose them, oppose their unjust practices, the practices that make them wealthy at the expense of the poor. Our citizenship is in heaven. Amen. And we should live as free men, but we need to defend the oppressed and the poor. And then finally, I want to close with this. Proverbs 22:7. "Do not enslave yourselves. The Egyptians freely offered themselves into slavery. They became indebted to the Pharaoh. They gave up their freedom, their property, their very selves to Pharaoh." In Proverbs 22:7, it says, "The rich rules over the poor, and the borrower becomes the lender of the slaves, or the lender's slave." Throughout Scripture, we're told over and over again that when we go into debt, we become slaves to the lender. We enslave ourselves. And many people in this coronavirus pandemic are experiencing more and more pain and struggles because of indebtedness, because of promises that they have made based on what they thought was going to be prosperity going forward forever to the unseen future. And yet, in an instant, it was wiped away. The Bible urges us to not enslave ourselves, to live as free men. Do not become slaves to the lenders. Our citizenship is in heaven. Live as free men. Defend the oppressed and the poor, and do not enslave ourselves. Amen. Let's close, or let's move on to our communion hymn today. And our communion hymn will be Hear the Voice of Jesus Calling. And then Linda will give us our communion meditation. And I will have a prayer followed by a time of taking communion together. Let's sing page 669.
Sadie and his family have an open arms, open home philosophy. People are always welcome in their home, especially those who are in distress, he says. That's the kind of household he was grown up in Liberia, with his 9 siblings. Their parents always welcomed others into their family. He says, we grew up as a community. We loved one another. Everybody was responsible for everybody. My father taught us to love one another, care for each other, protect each other. When King David was in need, he found this type of loving care in God. 2 Samuel 22 and Psalms 18 records his song of praise to God for the way he had been in refuge for him throughout his life. He recalled, in my distress, I called to the Lord. I called out to my God. From his temples, he heard my voice. My cry came to his ears. God has delivered him from my enemies. including King Saul, many times. He praised God for being his fortress and delivered in whom he took refuge. While our distresses may be small in comparison to David, God welcomes us to run to him and find shelter with that we long for. His arms are always open. Therefore, we sing the praises of his name.
All right. And thank you, Mr. Hart. Let's bow as we thank the Lord for communion. Lord, as we gather around this table today, as we gather to prepare to partake of communion, we just thank you so much. We thank you for this opportunity that we've had to hear the words, your words, to remember the creation, the beginning of this country. But Lord, through it all, you are our God. Our citizenship is with you. And so we thank you that we have this opportunity now to come and thank you for the blessing of this communion, to celebrate you doing what we could not do ourselves, to celebrate you going to the cross, freely laying down your life. Greater love has no man than this, that he lays down his life for a friend. You did that for us. As we look back on Memorial Day, many people laid down their life for this country to go forward, for freedom to ring, but you gave the prime example. You paid the price for all of our sins. You washed them away on the cross. You said it was finished. So as we partake of this cup and this bread that represents your body and your blood, may you wipe our sins as you've wiped our sins as far as the east is from the west. Allow us to walk in the freedom that you've given us from sin. It's in your name we pray. Please join me as we say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is It's Well With My Soul, page 495. It is well with my soul. Please join me as we sing this, and then we will close with a prayer.
Whatever my life.
Amen. Let's close with prayer. I thank you so much for joining us today, joining us online, and those who are here. Family, thank you for being part of this. I hope that your Memorial Day weekend is an awesome weekend where you get to declare God's glory as you remember those who have gone before, that have given their lives for our freedom, and that have sacrificed for our country. But most importantly, let's remember how God has given us the strength to continue on. Let's pray. Lord, today we thank you. We thank you for this day where we can celebrate in our country, not because you're an American or a Republican, but because you are our God. You have blessed us with a land that's bountiful with resources. You've blessed us with the sun, the moon, and the stars. You have continued to provide for us and sustain our life. And so, Lord, even in the midst of this pandemic, even when there's not national prosperity, you are working in us and through us. You are working all things for our good, and we trust you in that. And so, Lord, this morning, today, I pray for each person, and I pray for each person watching this, that your blessings will be upon them, that they can feel your love, your blessings of plenty and of peace, that they can go forth as your people and declare your glory to those around them, those who are lost and in darkness and are still enslaved by sin. Help us to live as free men because you have set us free. I thank you, Lord. It's in your name we pray. Amen.